Greetings, fellow investigators, and welcome back to our video podcast, Into the Darkness, where my friends and I play the Call of Cthulhu role-playing game. I'm your host, Tom Rayleigh. We continue now with episode 4 of In Dreams. It was written by Jerry Bryant, and he is also our game master. I will be doing the recap as my character, Sevan Andrushko. So hold on to your sanity. The players are ready. Let's begin our journey into the darkness. The flight to Denver was almost a disaster. Lightning struck the plane and we almost crashed. It was a very rough landing. I think it would be better to walk back to Massachusetts than to fly. We took the opportunity before we traveled to the old asylum to do a little research and discovered that it had been closed when a strange affliction plagued a number of the patients. We purchased breathing masks in order to protect ourselves just in case. Eventually, we traveled to Aspen, a nice little skiing village, but we must always remember that no matter how lovely a place may be, there is always shadows and places for the dark things to hide and to watch us. We thought, too, in some way, we passed the cemetery. I missed it. Oh, sorry. Cut this part out. We passed the cemetery and finally came into view of the asylum. It was as we had seen it in our dreams, except for the presence of the German car. Its occupants were already inside the building. We thought to, in some way, sabotage their vehicle, but instead we opted simply to hide our own. Instead, inside, we searched, thinking that our goal was in the attic. We came upon one of the German men ransacking one of the offices, but he seemed strange. He was covered in odd yellow legions. We attempted to sneak past, but he heard us. In the ensuing scuffle, Jacob managed to wound and blind the man, effectively removing him as a threat. But something came over Miss Gordon. Perhaps it was the stress that made her lose control. She was, as we understand it, a self-proclaimed Nazi hunter. A single shot to the man's skull rendered him effectively dead. We were all quite horrified by her actions. However, we were more horrified by the yellow effluence that poured from the man's wounds instead of blood. A while later, when we returned along the same path, there was no body at all. It had melted. We found nothing in the attic. It was then that Jacob remembered from our dream that along with the trap door, there had been a piano in the room. We made our way back to the first floor in search of a common room, the most likely place to find a piano. Another German was there, hanging at the end of a rope in the center of the room, with similar sores in as his melted comrade upstairs. We secured his passport and his keys. A note describing the mask and the mention of our names were in his pocket. The order to recover the mask and to eliminate us was also there. So I feel less remorse for the two dead men. Finally, in a storage room just beyond the kitchen, we found, at last, a piano. There in the floor was the trap door open, and from it we could hear something strange. A voice, perhaps. It sounded like gibberish to me. And that is where we are now, standing over this trap door. Jerry?
Yeah, so you're standing over the trap door. The room is full of dust. You hear a strange mumbling underneath the trap door, and there we go. What are you going to do?
Is there any light coming from down there?
No, there is no light coming from down there. I mean, there's ambient light from windows and stuff that's in this room, but I mean, none of the electricity is working.
Are there stairs going down?
I don't know. You have to open up the trap door.
You said it was open.
Oh. Okay, sorry. Yes, there are stairs going down. They're like normal stairs, not like a ladder. They're like normal stairway.
Okay.
How distant do the voices seem?
the voices, the or the voice sounds like it's nearby. It's definitely coming from underneath the floor where you're at, you know, but you're not exactly sure location wise.
Does it sound echoey?
It sounds muffled, like it's in another room.
I'll flash a light down into the opening.
Well, there is actually ambient light coming in from a row of windows along one wall. From the, this is like, if you were to look at this from the outside, this is like the basement. You've seen those little hatchway doors that open up out there. Well, imagine that as a row of skylights.
Okay.
So there is ambient light in the room.
Before you shine your light down there, because if he can see, it will tell him that somebody's here. I'm going to get down on my hands and knees next to the trap door and lower my head down so that I can see just inside rather than going. Is that possible?
Yes.
Or is it a stairwell?
It's a stairwell, but I mean, you could take and look down and see, for the most part, the entire room. Not all of it, but you can see, for the most part, the entire room just by getting down on the floor and looking.
Okay, so that's what I want to do. I want to do a peek.
It is a small room, about 15 by 15, and off to your left, at the bottom of the stairs, there is a blue door, slightly ajar. There's no furniture in the room outside of peeling paint, the smell of mold, and just, you know, detritus on the floor.
So there's nobody in that room.
No, there's nobody in the room.
There's nobody in the room below, but there is another door. Was there any light coming from the other door?
Yes, there's light coming from the other door.
There is, and I'm saying this very quietly to everybody, there is another room. But I think that if we're quiet, we can all get down into this one without making noise.
Is the door in place?
It's a little ajar, and there's light coming through.
All right. If we go down there and we see someone and they go aggressive, we could block them in if the door is in place.
Yeah, I think so. If we can do it without making any noise.
I'm still making
one at a time, trying to move nice and quiet and slow.
Yeah. I'm still making sure no one creeps around behind us and comes up behind us.
Yeah. And I have my gun. I mean, could be a nasty situation.
While you're concentrating on what you're going to do, you hear on the other side of what you're guessing is that other room a scream, and in silence.
Like a man's scream or a woman's scream? Okay, I almost peed my pants there. Let's go down very quietly.
Was it the same voice that was screaming? Can we tell?
Well, you're not really sure because the scream was loud and piercing, whereas in the voice was just kind of mumbling under its breath. So it wasn't as discernible. So, you know, the octaves would have changed from a mumble to a scream, so you're not sure it's the same voice.
But the voice stopped.
The voice stopped. It's dead silent.
We heard this before.
So you go down.
Yeah.
And you're standing at the blue door. There is no doorknob on it. The doorknob is missing. It's just sitting there loose.
Sanford, you go first.
Okay, well, I can try to open up the door if you want to be ready with your gun, just in case.
Can we try to peek?
Well, yeah, you can peek in the room. Let's try to peek. Without opening the door at all, you can see is that the room is full of boxes, and you see a pair of legs sticking out from one wall.
All right, carefully, Joseph, please.
So you open the door.
Yeah, I take my cane and try to push the door open, you know, kind of stand out of the way a bit.
It comes in towards you.
Okay.
So you open it up, and you step in the room?
Well, want to look and make sure there's nobody standing there.
Yeah, no, there's nobody standing in the room. All you see is a pair of legs. You know, like, is it the person sitting down on the floor up against the side where the windows are?
Okay, so the legs are pointing upwards. I mean, the feet are this way, not this way. All right.
Good, just a sec. I'm gonna step into the room 7. Just watch my back here. So.
Okay. First of all, when you walk into the room, there's, like I said, there's boxes and dust everywhere. Up against the wall next to the window is Mr. Gruber sitting on the floor with this rictus of pain on his face, and in his hand he's holding the mask.
I bet he is thinking Shiza now. Do you think he tried to put on the mask?
Oh, he probably did. Do we have a cloth or something I can try to grab the mask?
Is he alive?
I can throw over the mask and take it. Then let's get the hell out of here.
Yeah, it's not looking like he put on the mask, though.
We brought some sort of a bag to put the mask in. Oh, and a hat.
We brought a hat box.
Well, we could wrap it around a raincoat.
And to you now.
All right, very carefully. Don't let it touch your flesh, because who knows?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking the same thing.
Can you maybe hook one of the eye holes? Are there eye holes?
Yeah, there are eye holes.
Maybe you can hook one of the eye holes with your cane, and we can very carefully drop it into the hat box.
Good idea. Okay, I'll put the hat box beside it. So what about Gruber? Is he even...
Oh, he looks quite dead.
Oh, okay. That's good. Okay, well,
is he like melting or whatever?
No, he is not. He does not have the yellow goo on him.
Can we find the mask?
Can we see the box that we saw with the mask?
Yeah, the box is there. Mm-hmm. It looks like he had pulled it out and set it on the floor and had just opened it up and pulled out the mask when he had a heart attack or whatever it was.
Should we put the mask back in the box and then the box into the hat box?
The box will not fit into the hat box.
Okay. Well, do you know what? I'm going to probably get the mask into the hat box. I'll do that first, then let's get the hell out of here, I think.
We could put the mask in its box and then wrap it around with one of our raincoats, probably.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For sure, I have an overcoat that I can wrap it around. I just take off my coat.
While you're doing this, you notice this sound from outside. This, you're not really sure what it sounds like. It's like this rapid beating sound.
I'm still upstairs, so can I see out of a window or anything?
No, you cannot see. You don't see anything.
Okay. I'm still keeping an eye open.
I'll keep an eye on Mr. Gruber.
Okay, well, he looks to be dead. That doesn't seem to be changing.
So I have the box wrapped up in my overcoat, so I guess let's take this out to the car and get out of here.
Okay.
You know, Steph, do you want to walk ahead and, you know, kind of guide us, you know, keep a lookout? You know, at least you have a gun with you, so.
Yes, let's... I don't think that there were any more than 3 of them, and then now they are all accounted for. Yes, but let us go carefully.
So you go upstairs, you get back to your car, no problems.
Okay.
Head back.
Now the
question. Do you see anything that might have been whatever was making that noise?
Well, speaking of which, everybody roll spot hidden.
I had to open my mouth.
It's bound to happen.
Yes. 49.
Ooh. 13. Wow.
Yes, 39.
My last spot roll, I go insane.
Who failed the spot hidden?
Me.
Okay. For those that pass the spot hidden, you have plenty of time to hit the deck. Those that did not pass the spot hidden, this large, leathery creature with a huge wingspan comes over the top of the roof of the building and dives right towards you. And it's kind of a dark, bluish skin. Big, huge wings.
It's a thing from the plane, isn't it?
Huh?
It's a thing from the plane, isn't it?
Yes, actually, it is. And everybody make a sanity roll. If you pass
one.
If you pass it, 1 point. If you fail it, 1d6.
Ooh, I fail.
I fail.
That's awesome.
I pass.
Two.
Oops. Oh, it's one of them again.
Where's my d6? Ooh, a six. Ow. That hurts.
Uh-oh.
Well, that's 14 sanity.
Oh, my God.
Well, now you were saying that if we passed our spot hidden,
it's just 1 point. Yeah, I'm sorry. You still have to take the sanity roll. You
I'm just not talking have about time. The sanity.
Yeah, you just have time to drop to the ground so we can't attack you.
What about the people who didn't pass it?
They're going to have to get. We're going to have to see who gets attacked or attempted to be attacked. Now, Joseph, you failed your sanity roll. You took 6 points.
Yes.
Oops. Well, you want to do the cards or do you want me to?
Did you printed out your own cards?
Yep.
Could be your lucky dad.
Well, you're the GM.
All right. Just tell me when you want a card.
There.
Roll a d6.
Aha.
He's waiting.
Four.
All right. You got disability. Your leg, we'll say your left leg, doesn't specify. We'll say your left leg just freezes up and stops moving. Since you're already on the ground, you just won't be able to stand.
Okay. That's great.
So that wasn't too bad. Now, we got three people who did not make the spot hidden, so they're standing. So we're going to go Simon, Eddie, Louie, and missing boy, Jason. Jason. Damn, I wish I knew what his hit points were. All right, so Jason got attacked. Does that shit do impaling? Oh, fuck. I'm just going to roll this out publicly because I don't have the six-siders here with me. Jason took 12 points of damage.
That's most likely all of his points.
Yeah, I'm going to say that's...
Head off.
It literally just ripped his head off. Unfortunately... Since he was a friend of yours, that means another sanity roll.
Oh, no. Jason, I told you you'd lose your head.
It just literally ripped his head right off. And so the body's standing there quivering and blood shooting out of the neck.
I got an old fella.
What was my husband's name?
What do you get if you pass?
Damn it.
What do you lose if you pass?
Just 1 point.
Yeah, he's all right, I guess.
You didn't like him that much.
No. So we all make a sanity.
He was nothing like my husband.
If you fail the sanity roll, then it's a D6. And yes, even though you're laying on the ground paralyzed, you still have to make a sanity roll.
Okay.
Because your buddy just got his head literally ripped right off.
Where is his brains?
For the record, that was completely random. I did not target him specifically. I guess that worked out, though.
Okay, I failed.
Sorry, Jason.
Sanity. And I rolled a two.
Now, Tom, what does that do since he's already in the process of psychosis and he's having to make another sanity roll? Does that extend it or not?
I actually, usually when you're in the middle of it, you don't do anything, do you?
Yeah. One typically lasts for rounds. Indefinite lasts for literally months or years, doesn't it?
I know, so, but when you're suffering, when you're still in the rounds for your first attack, I don't think that you can suffer anymore.
Need an idea roll, doesn't he?
That's I don't true. Think I've actually ever encountered two sanity rolls that quick on top of each other, so...
Plus, if it's Mythos-related insanity, for the first time you get 5% extra Cthulhu Mythos.
Well, then you all get at 5% Cthulhu Mythos, because...
I didn't go insane, so...
Well, it's your call. You're the GM, but
I'm just going to say that it just adds to it. It's not going to give him another psychosis or anything like that.
His other leg stops working.
He just pees his pants a little.
Oh, that's
fine. Okay.
But then again, you know, that is like, that's now 8 in a very short order. I would be very careful about sanity loss at this point in time.
At least you've got some Cthulhu Mythos now.
Yeah, you got some Cthulhu Mythos.
How big is this thing?
It's huge. Well,
I already had some. Hey, can I roll Cthulhu Mythos to see if I know what the thing is?
Sure.
Because I read the Necronomicon, or at least I started to. Ah, 82. No, I don't know what it is.
It's a big bird thing. But, so anyway, the bird swoops down, rips his head off, and then pulls back up. You guys get a chance to do something if you want to do something.
I'm going to shoot it.
I drew my gun because I didn't have it. I had it holstered because we're heading back to the car. So I'm going to have to draw my gun.
Get inside. It can go in, apparently.
In fact, my 9mm automatic, I can shoot three shots in a round. So I'm just going to...
Okay.
Got it. Shall I roll?
Yeah, go ahead, roll. Juan, are you going to run for the building?
I want to pick Joseph and carry him inside into the building.
Okay, so you grab Joseph and you guys are limping away from the group of people towards the building.
Split run the away. Party!
Get inside!
Take a shot at this thing.
Towards the building or the car?
I'm sure you can catch up with the car and pick it up if you want.
50. Meet that.
It looks odd what I did. It's the first three that count. The first one hit, the second one missed, and the third one was an 06.
Okay, so that's impaling. The third one would be impaling.
Right. Damage. How close is it?
It's about 10 feet from, you know, hovering up above, about 10 feet up.
Okay, so it's close.
Yeah, I'd say so.
Well, then my damage would theoretically be 2 d10s.
Well, no, if it's an impale, then it's max damage.
Okay, so it's max damage plus 1d10. Roll. So 18. I did 18 damage to it.
Minus two. So let's see.
That's assuming bullets do anything to it.
Oh, yeah, they definitely do something to it, but it does have armor, so... Wow. It hurt it pretty bad. But it's not, it's still there, but I mean, it hurt it pretty bad. All right, Polly? Did you hit?
I did. I got 50 out of 60.
All right.
Down that it's a D10 plus 2.
Okay.
So 5.
Shit. Well, I see this.
I winged it.
That's 3. No, actually, it killed it. Between the two of your shots, it killed it. Damn, Impale. So it just crumples to the ground. Bam! Lands at a big splat.
Right on top of Jason's, on Sanford's body.
His headless corpse.
I'm going to get to my car, start it up, and go to the factory so Joseph doesn't have to walk too far because of his leg injury.
I'm really rattled, but I'm like, I am not so sure we need to give this mask back to the guy from Egypt. This is crazy shit.
No, we're giving it to him so we get the money. If we don't give it to him, we're not going to get the money.
Well, we've already lost one of our people because of this stupid thing. Now we have blue demons coming out of the sky and attacking us.
That's why he was paying us so much. This is going to put my daughter through college.
Do we split his hair? What's
the pain?
Okay, so what are you going to do?
Is Joseph's leg better?
You're going to pull the car up to pick up the wounded Joseph?
Yeah. I want to get a look at this thing closer.
It's a big, nasty looking. It's got wings. It's got a barrel-shaped body, but its head looks like kind of like a cross between a dog and an alligator.
I want to take a picture.
Yeah, take a picture. Take a lot of pictures.
You guys posing with it, like putting your arm around it?
I was thinking of doing that very thing with the Nazis.
Yeah.
I kind of want to take a souvenir.
Everyone you showed us the photograph to will have to make a sanity roll. You do realize that, don't you?
A fingernail or a tooth.
Well, we're a film show and your whole family goes fucking mental.
We're part of a paranormal normal investigation group. Gotta
be perfect to work out at a family reunion.
The photograph will have to make a sanity roll, won't it?
Oh, you said it'd be perfect to whip out at a family reunion. Their family's all crazy anyway.
It's,
you're going to make a sanity roll from seeing it. You're going to make a sanity roll if you see a photograph of it, aren't you?
Is there anything I can take as a souvenir? Does it have hair? Does it have
fingernails? Yeah, it's got scraggly hair all over it.
Take a claw from the tip of its wing or something.
Yeah, claws.
Yeah, make a necklace claws out of it. On the end of its wing.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
You got an axe?
Take it.
I have a
pocket. I have a toolbox. Maybe I can use pliers or something. I have bolt cutters.
Ah, bolt cutters would work.
Yeah.
So what's from the car?
I don't know why I have this incredible fascination with taking some of its body parts, but
yeah, do I need to do a sanity roll to watch my companions here rip apart this creature?
It's just like kidnapping a rabbit.
Only if they start eating it.
They're souvenir hunters, you know, so so you get the claw off the tip of the wing. Bolt cutters are amazing things.
Yeah.
Ooh, yeah, can you get me those. Another one for me?
Here, Annie Oakley, with your shooting the gun. Here, you get one yourself.
Okay, I take it and I grab one. And
right. I high-five. Well, yeah, it's got two wings, so you can clip off both of them.
You wanna make a necklace out of its eyeballs?
That's awesome.
Yes, I do. Like, you know those people who will wear a bullet. I'm going to wear a claw.
Just so you're aware, there's not a swastika on this bird.
So?
All right, so you get your souvenirs. Joseph's leg is getting better.
Joseph, you can walk.
Yes, I can.
You better get up and walk, or they're going to cut it off and take it as a souvenir.
I know, I know.
Let's drive back. Get back to familiar ground.
Where are you driving back to?
The local hotel where you came from.
Okay.
And from there, we got our stuff together and go home, I should imagine. Fly home.
We could probably get back to the hotel and call, what's his name? Jackson. Tell him that.
That's the box.
So you call, Jackson, and he goes, hello.
We have succeeded, Jackson, in obtaining the mask.
Did you put it on?
Are you crazy? We won't even touch it. You wouldn't believe the shit that we've seen.
He goes, well, get it on back here as soon as possible.
Tell Mr. Hamadati that, oh, one of our members is dead. You remember Sanford?
That's not good.
Yeah, he didn't make it. Ooh. He was, to be honest, he was attacked by a big, gigantic blue demon thing.
A blue demon.
We have pictures and souvenirs.
Okay.
Okay. I think we might need to renegotiate the price with Mr. Hamadati as far as this goes.
I was going to say, maybe
how much did he say he was going to give us?
He was going to give you $6,000 a piece total.
Six each. That's after I made him haggle.
Yeah, we need to go way beyond that because $6,000 in 1970 is shit.
That's still a lot of money in 1970.
But no, contracts,
I'd like
contracts?
To have that now.
Couldn't buy a car for it.
$6,000 in 1920, you get absolutely.
Well, yes, but this is 1970. He give us a million.
Even 1970, $6,000. I'm gonna put my daughter through college.
Okay, so going to stay in the hotel for the night? Or are you gonna get up and go straight to the airport?
Well, what time is it?
It's like about 4 p.m.
Do you guys want to go straight back?
Yes.
Yeah, don't stay here. I want to go back and get paid.
All right.
Let's get this over with. I'm sick of this thing.
Let's try to get to the plane tickets altogether.
So you guys get to the airport. You get your plane tickets. You get on the flight. You fly to...
Hold my hand, 70s. It'll be all right.
No problems.
Well, we would fly to Boston. We don't
know. Oh, Boston. Okay, well.
Arkham's too small.
You get off the plane, and you notice the skies are really dark and overcast. And the air is really still. And as you're walking to the terminal, this weird thing happens. It looks like the air in front of you is cracking.
What the hell is going on here?
You see cracks coming up in the air, and then a little piece of it falls out. And behind it is blackness. And a little piece falls out. And another little piece falls out. It just looks like that all around you is just cracked and shattered. And it's just falling down faster and faster until it just all crumbles. And you're standing in essence where you were before. But it's like, looks like an apocalypse has happened. It's all destroyed and dark and, you know, things are burnt and ripped. And off in the distance you can see fires and.
Okay, we are hallucinating.
We're all seeing this, right? At the airport?
Yeah, every one of you is seeing this.
Wow.
We did land.
Just all being awake.
Yeah. And it's another sanity roll.
I wondered if that one's coming up.
If you pass
27.
If you pass it, it's 1. Oh. If you fail it, it's a D8.
Oops. I keep having only 1s.
16 is again.
1D8, you
say? I fail. And
it's close. Got 2.
Ooh.
3.
I've lost 20 this whole session.
Ouchie.
It's not a big deal to play.
I mean,
that means that you're going to have to go see a psychiatrist.
Oh, yeah.
How many did you just lose this turn?
Just two.
Oh, okay.
I meant 20 for the whole game.
Oh, okay, not the whole session. So you've lost 10 throughout this session.
Yes.
How? What's your total? What's your total sanity originally?
50.
And 50. Technically, if you lose 20%, which is 10, in one day, then you're gonna have to go into the institution for a while.
We do get one day. I do. We get a couple of days. We flew back the day after.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I had 42 at the beginning of this session, so I'm lost 12.
Oh. All right, so you're going to have to see a psychiatrist.
Yeah.
Or you're going to be waking up screaming all the time.
To get him back.
Did anybody else fail?
Nope.
Yeah.
I'm basically a few sanity.
Yes, that's it.
Poor Joseph.
How many did you lose?
2 for me.
Oh, okay. Juan, how about you?
3.
Okay, so nothing major. Nothing major out of that. So you're standing there, like I said, in this ruined city. You can smell what smells like rotted meat and dirt and filth and mold. And, you know, the air is black. And there's like a really funky old yellow moon up in the sky, and
what the hell?
What's going on?
There was a war while we're on the plane.
No, this is after you got off the plane that this happened.
I know, but it looks like there's been a war while we were flying here. Well, we got off, took off, it was peace. We landed, and the country's disappeared in the meantime.
I think it would seem logical to assume that the mask is somehow projecting a hallucination into all of our minds. This can't be real. We were here.
Lord, I hope not.
Do we recognize any other like landmarks? Like, is the building for the airport still there?
Yeah, the building for the airport. It looks like it's still there. It's just in ruins.
Yeah. So we're in Arkham. It's just something. Spheres happened.
Is there something near me that, like a piece of meat or something that I could kick at and make sure that it's actually solid?
Well, I mean, there's rubble all over the ground.
Okay, I'm gonna tow a piece of, make sure it's actually there.
It's real.
And I sort of grab you by the shoulders and say, "Be careful. You could be kicking somebody's baby in the other world."
No, I would never do that.
We don't know that what we're seeing is real. It wasn't a chicken. It was a baby.
And as you're standing there, you know, you start to turn around and just like look all around you. And off in the distance, you see a dim yellow moon.
I don't think the moon should look like that.
Well, above you is the bright yellow moon. Off in the distance is a dim yellow moon.
Like we are in a different world.
I do like a double take, like here.
Right.
Well, at least we don't have to wait in a long line to get out. Let us move carefully through this apocalypse and see what it looks like outside.
All right, so you go through the terminal. Like I said, you know, there's like skeletons laying in the terminal, and there's just like paint peeling and the smell of rot and decay, and everything just looks like it's a million years old.
Step carefully. What's happening, Seven?
Yes, I'm thinking exactly what you just typed in.
Yep.
I don't know. I guess we make our way through and out to the front of the airport.
You get out through the terminal, and what you see before you is not what you recognize. I mean, it is a city in ruins. You know, there's a tower, and the city's in ruins and falling apart, and, you know, and off in the distance, you can see somebody dragging their leg, you know, as they walk from one building to the next, and there's like these bats in the air, and it is not Arkham, or not the Arkham you recognize.
Well, Joseph, looks like you're going to have to wait for that psychiatrist appointment.
I'm thinking
we're all going to be joining you there.
Yeah.
Should we just drive straight to the sanitarium just to
kill time? Yeah, just to save time.
Yeah.
You don't have a car. You never found your car.
Is there perhaps a gigantic tarantula we can all climb on the back of and drive to? We are now living in Halloween Town. This reminds me of Five Lanterns when we were there last.
Maybe we should wait and see if it's
Can passes. We find a car that looks like an abandoned car and see if we can get it to run?
No, there are no cars. There are no cars. There's no horses. The only transportation is on foot.
Well, Arkham is not a large town.
Well, let's at least make for a shelter.
Yeah.
Shall we try to head back? Shall we try to head back to our own headquarters? See what they look like.
I think so.
Yeah.
So that's what we're gonna do.
Okay. So after the first hour of walking, everybody takes a sanity point.
Just lowers it.
Not even a roll, just take a point?
Yep, just take a point. And you don't recognize anything. It's just like, it looks like another city entirely. Not even a modern city. Something like out of, you know, ancient Egypt or, you know, I mean, it's just the buildings look old and brickwork and everything's falling in and rotting and...
Is there anything that looks like the library?
Nope.
Do we see any yellow symbols?
Actually, you do. They're all over the place. You find it in a corner here, in a corner over there. Now that you're actually actively looking for it, you're going, hey, there's that symbol again.
We are probably in a padded room, And they are trying to convince us that we are not completely crazy, but I think we're completely crazy.
I totally agree.
Well, what a relief to have that established. Thank you, Seven.
You guys saw this before. How did you make it go away?
Well, we didn't make it go away. We left the library and it disappeared.
Oh,
yeah.
As you walk past a building, you notice that there's people standing in the building staring out at you. They look disheveled. They're dressed in rags. Their faces are dirty. They're hollow and sunken and emaciated.
This is all because of this mask. You realize that. That's the only thing. Maybe we should destroy this damn thing.
Yes. I'll look for a break or something.
Oh, there's plenty of bricks laying around.
Yeah, it's on and out. Yeah, I think we... At least we can try to smash it. I don't know if... This is so... I don't know if we are even going to break it, but we can try.
It means we won't get paid, but...
Well, we already got paid a portion. I think
this is evil magic.
So you go to smash the mask?
I don't think we should.
We have to try. We have to do something. I can't go on like this.
I think that we are not going to escape this unless we break it.
Well, but the mask is not in the hat box.
Well, no, the mask is in the box.
It's not in the box. The box is empty. The mask is gone.
Smash it anyway, Jacob. Smash the air. Maybe it's just making us hallucinate that it's not there. Smash, Jacob.
Did anyone put on the mask?
Oh my God, no.
No. Never.
No.
Did I put on the mask? And I peel the skin off my... No.
Magic!
I think I can get it if I just dig my fingernails in.
Sanity loss all around.
I'll stomp the empty box.
Okay, you stomp the empty box. It crushes the box.
There's nothing there.
Oh. I guess it's time to start eating each other. I mean, I don't know what I meant. Oh, this is horrible. I'm hungry and there's nothing to eat.
Oh, I forgot to put in a Denny's.
The service there is horrible anyway.
It is run by the blue demon things.
Yes.
Well, I'm at the loss for what to do at this point. We are lost in the dark realms of...
All right, so let's jump ahead a little bit. 6 hours later, you have lost 6 sanity points, one every hour. You don't take you don't take an insanity for it because they happen spread out, but it's one every hour. You have wandered around through this hellhole of a disaster film. You know, I mean, everything is all blowed up and destroyed and burnt, and the smell of rotten filth is everywhere. And you come to, like, not really a town square, but you come to an area where the buildings are void in one area, and there seems to be people gathered there.
What do they look like?
They look disheveled, wearing rags, and, you know, emaciated, filthy. They stink, body odor.
Any of them more distinguished than the rest?
No, they all look the same. In fact, you could not pick them out of a lineup. If you put them all up against each other, they pretty much look indistinguishable. I mean, you know, there might be one that's shorter, skinnier, fatter, whatever, but they're just... Think peasant.
Are any of them wearing masks?
Nope. Nobody is wearing a mask. There are a few that wish they did wear a mask because they're like horribly disfigured and burnt.
Do I still have my weapon?
Yeah, you have everything that you had on your person is mm-hmm. still on your person.
Okay. I'll start to approach the crowd to see what they're doing, what they're looking at.
Yeah, I'll go with you.
Okay, and you get there, and there's a big fire in the center, and they appear to be cooking something over a spit.
Thank God.
Food at last.
Backyard barbecue.
Whee.
And that was all good and fine up until you realize that this thing had arms and legs.
Well, you know, when you're hungry.
I will assume that you've seen enough dead bodies in this adventure that you're not going to really take any sanity loss. Though it is rather disturbing that they're cooking another human being.
We kind of expected it, though, at this point.
And the people just look at you.
Do they talk to each other at all?
They just look at you. They haven't said anything to you. They just look totally broken. Like they have had all their will destroyed.
I am feeling totally broken myself.
That is what is going to happen to us.
This is
going to
be us if we don't get out of here.
Can I ask one of them what year it is?
He just looks at you and he says, "Welcome to Carcosa." Then he turns back to what he was doing.
I knew it. The damn airplane landed at the wrong place, and we ended up in the wrong city.
Is this Mexico? Are we in Mexico?
Yeah, it sounds like Mexico.
No, it looks more like Burbank.
Well, back to the airport, because we got to get on the plane to the right city.
So you guys go back?
No, I'm joking.
No, not another 6 hours.
Can I do another Cthulhu roll?
Yes, you can.
Because I was reading about Haster.
Okay.
Nope.
What is your skill with the Cthulhu mythos?
I'm at 15 right now.
Okay, that's not too bad. Everybody else has Cthulhu mythos too now.
Yeah.
We do?
Yeah, you've got 5% because you saw the big blue creature.
Oh, okay.
I had just extra because I read the Necronomicon. I started reading the Necronomicon.
69 now. Is there any high ruin or any vantage point that we can get to?
Nope. I mean, you can see that the city stretches out for miles and miles and miles, but you don't perceive a noticeable that you're like up on a hill or anything like that. It just seems flat, but you can see, you know, the tops of buildings for miles off into the distance. It's kind of weird. The angles of time are kind of weird. You do smell something in the air, though, that you didn't smell before. It smells like not quite the ocean, but there is obviously a body of water around someplace.
We should follow the smell. That's the only lead we have.
Sounds about right.
All right. Lead the way.
I'll be following the smell.
Okay, so you follow the smell, and eventually you come to the edge of the city. That's another 4 hours, another 4 sanity points. Anybody run out yet?
I'm at 19.
40.
No, I still have 41.
And you come to
the
bank of a huge lake. The lake is completely still and quiet.
What color is the water?
I don't remember this lake being anywhere near Arkham. So
it's black. But then again, you know, it looks like night. So, I mean, it's the water's always going to be kind of black looking at night anyway.
Perhaps we should get on a boat and get away from this place.
Anything like that?
Are there docks?
There is no boats.
It is difficult not to despair at this point.
Any yellow signs?
Not now that you're out of the city.
I almost wish we had the mask, because this thing is supposed to do is open doorways.
That may be a good thing. If I remember correctly, Savan said that the yellow signs were something related to danger, a warning.
Yes, and insanity, which is definitely what's going on in that city there.
Yeah. So, you take another 2 points of sanity over the next couple hours, and you're really exhausted, you're really tired, you're just getting wore down, you're going to have to sleep. You all huddle around together to stay warm, because the air is kind of cool at night. And out of nowhere, there is a large explosion. You don't feel, you're not blown back from it, but you can feel the wave of energy as it goes over your body. And now you're standing back in the room with the German and the mask. The German is wearing the mask.
What the hell?
Quick, get the mask off his face.
I'll just immediately like charge at him blindly and try to hit him.
Oh, he's dead. He's not.
Oh, I thought he was standing there with a mask.
He's attacking anyway, I expect.
Same position that you saw him in when you came across him, except for this time he's wearing the mask.
Try to kick the mask off his face then.
Yes.
Yeah, mask comes off real easy.
Well, is it
Jacob, you're talking to it.
Is there any evidence on our bodies that we were in that other place, or
there's dirt smudges, you know, you have the smell of, you know, body odor and decay on you. Your clothes look slightly dull, like the color is faded out of the clothes.
Is Sanford alive and with us?
He's not with you.
What do we do now? If we take the mask, are we going to end up back here again?
Well, I don't know about that, but I'm not taking an airplane back.
No.
Well, maybe we should call him to resecure
and ask him to meet us at the hotel. We should just go back to the hotel, tell him what's going on, and you know he can come out and get it from us.
And get it from us. That's not a bad idea.
We can mail it to him. We can mail it to them, certified mail.
If he's so rich, he can get on an airplane and come out and find us.
I don't want this thing in my possession for another minute.
Well, we have to take it out of here. Can't. Perhaps one of us should try on the mask.
I slap you.
Do it. Do it. Do it.
Chug. You get that from college.
You want to put on the mask?
No.
Let's get Sanford. He'll do it. He'll do anything.
Yeah, let's. He's dead.
Oh, that's right. He's missing his head too.
Or he doesn't exist.
Maybe well, then it would hurt him, will it?
Perhaps if you keep the mask on the dead person, you know, we could transport him in the trunk of the car, and it won't affect us because he's dead. I ain't carrying that fucking thing.
I have another question. I don't know if you can answer this.
We'll tie his feet together and drag him along. Yeah. Yes.
Jerry, what's our sanity look like now? Are we?
It's exactly where it was after you lost all that. You still lost all that sanity.
Still, we did. Okay.
Yeah, that was real loss.
Okay. I thought maybe we might have been transported and our.
Well, from going back to the real world?
Nope.
With the amount of sanity that I lost, I'm ready to put the mask on.
I think Joseph's probably ready too.
I've lost 25 this session.
I'm basically staring at the mask with the really big bulk outers and really considering smashing it.
I'm probably between putting the mask on and putting it on the ground and smashing it with my foot.
I'm considering that I'd never really liked any of you people anyways, and I'm just going to walk home. Keep your $6,000. It's not worth it.
Well, you're standing there in the room with a dead German and the mask and the box. You do not know where Sanford's at. You don't know if that was real or if it wasn't real.
Well, I remember it as if it was real.
Yes, I mean, but I'm saying is you haven't found Sanford's body, so you're not sure that it was real or not real.
It would be outside.
Is it basically the same time point that when we first walked into that room? Or did like 8 hours?
It feels like hours later.
So it would be, I guess, nighttime.
In fact, the sun would be down. It would be nighttime.
Yeah.
Did we knock the mask off the German's face?
Yes.
What's his face look like?
A rictus of pain, but nothing.
Not like
yellow boils or anything like that.
I'm going to carefully with my hands covered by whatever piece of cloth or fabric.
But you have garden gloves, remember?
Right. I'm going to put the mask into the box.
Okay. It goes into the box easy.
Is there a way to seal the box closed?
Yes, the box has a latch on it.
Okay, it has a big latch on it. Was there a lock?
Or? It's not a lock. It's just like one of those old-timey, you know, latch. It's got the little arm with a little peg in it, and you just pull it down, and the peg goes through the lock mechanism and locks it into place.
Okay. And I pick up the box and I say, let's get the hell out of here.
I would like to secure the latches with some zip ties.
Okay.
Okay, yeah. Man.
Just you in can case.
Secure it with zip ties.
Let's go.
I am. I feel like if there's some horrible thing about to drop on our heads, I just assume that it dropped quickly. So let's go.
Snap a picture of the German.
Okay, so you go outside.
So that I can document what's been happening.
You go outside. Sanford is there, missing his head, and there's a large blue monster starting to melt in the driveway.
Well, what did the police officer say we should do about Sanford?
Well, we can't do anything, can we? Because it just automatically incriminates us.
So we just leave the body here?
I've not really experienced it. I know how to find people who dump bodies, so I've never actually tried doing it myself.
It would be, how would we ever explain the headless body?
That's what I mean, then explain everything else, which we're not going to be able to do.
Maybe we should pull him inside the asylum and leave him there.
Well, out here, the animals will eat him.
Lead him in there, too, but at least no one driving past will see him.
No, nobody drives past this. We're out in the middle of nowhere.
The German's car is still here, so if anything, it would probably be associated with that. And what happened then? I'm not taking their car now. I've got a hired car. You can take it. I'm not taking it. I'm taking the hired car.
Can we take the train back instead of the airplane?
Yes, there's a train that runs.
I'm with you, Seven.
On the East Coast, there's trains that run everywhere.
We're in Colorado.
Yeah, but there'd be a train that would go over
to the east.
We'll probably go to the Chicago first.
What expenses to get train tickets, no problem. Because we're not paying for it.
Well, let us.
But I still think we should stay at the hotel, call them up, you know, tell them to come
here. That is actually a pretty good idea.
I don't think we should risk going back. We should stay at the hotel, call him up. He'll find a way to get here, and that's it.
Head for the hotel. The hotel doesn't stink of death like this factory does.
Let's go.
That's a good idea.
All right, so you go back to the hotel. Nothing to miss. You get your room. You pick up the phone. Make a phone call and tell him that you have the mask. And that if he wants it, he has to come get it, correct?
Yes.
Because we might
he's willing to come up there and get it.
Right.
But it's going to take 2 days.
That's fine.
Okay. So 2 days progress relatively uneventful. Lots of Denny's trips. And he shows up at your door. And he goes, "You have my mask.
Please come in, Mr. Hamadati." Yes.
He comes in and his two assistants come in and stand at the door behind him.
Would you mind if, considering what we have gone through, would you mind explaining what has happened to us? And I therefore, we tell him everything that's happened involved with this mask.
Well, he looks disinterested completely. The two bodyguards behind him are kind of snickering a little bit. But he basically tells you and goes, "I told you not to put on the mask."
"We have not put on the mask."
"Somebody did."
"Well, not one of us."
"And you were transported to a place that you do not want to be."
"Yes, Carcosa."
"Then you know the name."
"Yes, and we were there for quite a long time."
"It's a miracle that you survived."
"It's a miracle that we didn't join in the feast when they were eating that person, but,
He just kind of snickers.
What do you want with this mask? It is obviously incredibly dangerous."
"Well, I collect antiquities. I'm going to put it in my display case and have it in my house as a display."
"You should put it behind 3 inches of acrylic so that nobody can get to it."
"Did you bring the cash?" "That's what I want."
He takes and pulls out a suitcase. You know, well, actually, the attendant hands it to him, and he opens it up, and it's full of cash.
Excellent. Excellent.
"Would you mind if we counted it so that we could make sure before we let the mask go to you? Only take us a few moments."
"I've also included the cash for your missing friend. You're welcome to have it as well."
"Oh, that's an extra $1,000.
We're going to need it for our psychiatry visit."
"All right."
He just kind of smirks at that.
"A long stay."
So how much should we get in total?
Well, let's see. It was $7,000. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, Six. So you basically have an extra 1,000 each with some money to go to Denny's on.
I'm going to go fishing.
Waffles.
I've got a fishing holiday due to me.
I'm going back to the Miskatonic so that I can research some more of the Necronomicon.
This is officially the end of the adventure. Now I'm sure you would like to know what happened.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, sure. Yes, please.
Mr. Hamadami is actually Narlothep. He wanted to breed chaos in the world. So he sent you on a task to find the mask, hoping that someone would put it on and thus create the atmosphere that you encountered. The two bodyguards are Chochos.
Ah.
And it's that simple. There was nothing complex about the plot. He wanted you to go find the mask so that he could drive people insane.
And he's going also to the guy who was paying the Germans.
Yes, he actually was paying the Germans too. He's going to send the mask back out in the wild and have somebody else go look for it now.
Oh, bastard. Love it.
Nice.
And were the Germans really Nazis?
Yes, they actually were Nazis. In the beginning, when I was writing the story, I was trying to choose between KGB or Nazis.
Yes, I'm glad you didn't choose KGB.
And I just went with Nazis because they're considered more evil.
Hmm. Which is ironic, really.
They are all.
It was that simple. It was, like I say, it was a very straightforward plot. That simple. I, you know, had one of you put on the mask. There were other added benefits. Cthulhu mythos spells. The ability to open up a doorway to someplace else. The ability to open up a doorway to Carcosa. And it just so happens that the German beat you to the mask. But all of that that you saw was real. It was just like it was in a different dimension. So it was like outside of your timeline, but it all happened for real.
But if we'd have put on the mask, it would have killed us, right?
Like no, not necessarily. Not necessarily. I mean, yes, you would have lost sanity, but no more than you had already lost from the trip to Carcosa. But in the beginning, me and you would talk, Tom, about, and don't mention it, but me and you would talk about another idea that I was wanting to play out.
Right.
And I decided not to do that, to use the Germans instead. And since I used the Germans instead, it just seemed logical to me that the Germans would make the bad move and do the wrong thing.
Right. All right. Well, that was a great game. Let's see. Before we completely end it, we're putting together 4 shows a week, folks. And if you'd like to help us out a little, at the end of the credits, you'll see there's a button that will take you to our Patreon account. A contribution of a couple of bucks a month would be greatly appreciated. Our players included Kim Smeltzer, Jeff Wilkins, Simon Ward, Greg Malcolm, John Rosansky, Jason Smith, and myself, with Jerry Bryant as the Keeper of the Secrets. Our musical intro, My Nightmares, was provided by Purple Planet Music, and a link to their site can be found in the description below. We provide audio-only versions of our shows free for you to download from Podbean or iTunes. Feel free to send us comments on the show. We'd love to hear from you. If you enjoyed our broadcast, please give us a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel for the latest on our shows. You'll find links to everything that I mentioned in the description below. This is Tom Rayleigh, inviting you to journey with us once again into the darkness for another adventure into the universe of H.P. Lovecraft and the Call of Cthulhu role-playing game. Until next time, good luck and good gaming.